Come on, why don't we just declare that he's worthy together? We sing.
You're worthy of every song we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
We sing Jesus.
In Jesus, the name above every other name. In Jesus, the only one who could ever save.
Holy
and holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and
you tonight. There has never been a better time to declare your need for Jesus, to declare your dependency on the name of Jesus. So come on, why don't we just come together in different rooms, in different locations tonight, and declare that no matter our circumstance, we will build our life on his love, that he is faithful, that he is a firm foundation. So come on, would you lift your faith with me tonight? We sing.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm found. I will put my trust. We put our trust in you. Oh, and I will not be shaken. Will build my
Church, wherever you are all along the military highway, welcome to Manna Church Online. This is our Thursday night service coming to you live right here from the Cliffdale site. My name's Riley. I'm the Cliffdale site pastor, and it is such a joy to be worshiping together with you. And, you know, I want to say welcome to any of you joining us for the very first time. You'll probably notice what's going on in this window, this browser that you're looking at. There's actually a couple of ways that you can interact with our team here. We have our staff on standby, ready to chat with you. You can even go online, use some social media stuff, and hashtag MyManaOnline. Let us know about your experience. We would love to see that. And, you know, maybe you are joining us for the first time, and we would actually love to get to connect with you, maybe get some more information about you. You'll notice that there's a tab on this screen. It's called a connection card. Would you go ahead and begin to fill that out? What that card does, it simply tells us who you are, and it lets us know that you were here. And in a couple of moments, we're going to have a time together where we continue to worship God through giving. If this is your first time, I don't want you to feel any pressure to give anything financially. Simply fill out that connection card and consider that your contribution tonight. And you know, like I said, our team's there, they're ready to connect with you. But maybe you have a prayer request, maybe you have an area where we could serve you. Would you consider sending us an email to contact@manna.church? You can even visit our website. You can find more ways to get connected there with our spiritual family. I'm just excited that we can get beyond just proximity and still figure out ways to gather in this virtual setting. And you know, since we're in this virtual setting, normally the offering buckets would come by, but that bucket today is a button. And would you do me a huge favor? If you came prepared to give, thank you for your generosity. Would you give to that button? In fact, we actually have an option for you to text to give. Here's how you do it. Text the word manna to the number you see right here at the bottom of the screen, and we would love to partner with you in changing the world all around the military highway. Amen. Well, let's pray together. Jesus, we're just so thankful. As a moment ago, we were singing to you how we need you. In any moment, in any circumstance, God, we can cry out to you knowing that you're good, knowing that you're faithful. So in response to who you are, we want to say that we trust you. We want to say that we put you first. And God, we want to be bold and ask you to multiply this offering to do more than we could even dream or imagine right here in the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region, all around the military highway and even to the ends of the earth. We declare, come thy kingdom and be done thy will in Jesus' name. Amen. Awesome, man. A family, well, do me another favor. Check out these video announcements and prepare your hearts for episode 4 of Life Together.
Hey everybody, thanks for worshiping with us in a digital space. You know, even though we're not able to gather under one roof, we can gather under one name, and that's the name of Jesus. Regardless of what time you're watching this, I'm here to remind you, Sunday at 12:30 p.m., right in this space, we've got our Manna Kids event. So regardless of when you're streaming this, I want to make sure you're here. So gather the whole family, manna.church. We can't wait to worship Jesus with you, kids.
What's going on, Manna Church? It's so good to be with you today. I wish we could be here with you in person, but this is the next best thing. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is James Lewis, and I'm the executive pastor, or one of the executive pastors here at the Fayetteville Fort Bragg location, and also the Ramsey Street site pastor. What's going on, Ram fam? And this right here is my lovely wife of almost 24 years, Kristen.
Hi, everybody.
So today we're going to bring with you episode 4 of Life Together. And hasn't it been so much fun going through this series, hearing from couples, learning tips and practices and fun things that we can do to help our relationships, things that you can take home right now and things you can use today in all of your relationships. You know, this is a series for friends, those living single and married with children. We want to help you experience home improvement and see your relationships blossom. Whether empty nesters or you have a full house, we believe that family matters. We live in a different world and all experience growing pains. But step by step, we will intend to help you clearly see who's the boss.
So over the past few weeks, we have been learning about some of the vital areas for every relationship. We started the series off with an episode on single, not solo, then friendship factor, and last week we learned to not avoid or be afraid of conflict, but to fight fair. Today we're going to talk about communication, and next week we'll wrap up the series with an episode on relationship roadblocks. If you've missed any of these episodes, I highly encourage you to go to our website, manna.church, our app, or the YouTube channel, and check them out. So, communication. We learned in the series 2020 Vision about the importance of the things we say to our vision and purpose. Well, not surprisingly, what we say is also very important in all of our relationships. So we're going to spend today talking about some practical tips to improve your communication in all of your relationships, whether it's your marriage, your family, your friends, your coworkers. We also want to hear what God says is important about how we talk to others, because what we say and how we listen to others is important to God. He warns us in Proverbs 18:21 that the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Not only that, but Jesus says in Matthew 12:36-37, I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak, for by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned.
You know, speaking of being condemned, I heard about a couple that were in their small group, and when during their small group time of interaction, the subject of marriage counseling came up. And the husband, in all of his infinite wisdom, says, oh, we'll never need marriage counseling. We have a great relationship. And so the people in the small group were like, oh, yes, do tell, do tell. And he said, well, it's quite simple. My wife was a communications major in college, and I was a theater arts major in college. And I said, go on. And he said, well, it's easy. She's very good at communicating, and I act like I'm listening.
That's terrible.
Yes, that's not good. And quite frankly, that's a rookie move on his part. Go ahead and give him my contact information, because he's going to be calling me for marriage counseling. So does the Bible provide principles for good communication and interpersonal relationships? Well, yes, of course it does. And one of the key principles can be found in the book of James, James chapter 1, verse 19. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Three keys to communication. Many of the communication pitfalls that we face that wreck our daily lives and wreck our relationships come from violating these three keys. We tend to get it all mixed up. We're, first of all, slow to listen, then we're quick to speak our minds, and then the resulting confusion and chaos and selfishness, we're quick to get all up in our feelings and get angry. Now, again, Kristen and I have been married for almost 24 years now, and while we do communicate fairly well now, that wasn't always the case. At least most of the time we communicate well. The first few years of our marriage, on the other hand, were very rough because we were so bad at these principles. We are both type A personalities, and both of us are very determined and very determined to win, whether it's to get our points across or win at every single thing we do. And that includes decisions, discussions, and the inevitable arguments that ensue. We embody the exact antithesis of what James is talking about and directing here. We're slow as molasses to listen. We're quick to talk, so quick to talk, in fact, that we've talked over each other and past one another. And we were very, extremely, outrageously short-fused.
So our arguing and dysfunctional roller coaster was really bad the first few years of marriage. There was hardly any listening, definitely not much understanding, but a whole lot of getting mad. But a friend lived with us for a few months in Colorado, our first duty station, and he watched us argue so much that he swore he was never going to get married.
And you know, like we talked about last week, ironing, sharpening iron. Well, that spark right there, that from that ironing, sharpening iron, from that statement that he was never getting married from watching us, really caused us to light a fire in ourselves and really form new habits. We learned new methods of communication. We attended marriage small groups, and we went to counseling even. And we got so much better in communication. In fact, a few years later, we saw our friend on a regular basis quite a lot and displayed what looked like a whole new marriage to him. So much so that he recanted his no marriage statement and got married himself just a few years later. And this is largely because we followed these directions from James. So if you're in a place where your communication is lacking or in need of some serious renovation, fear not. There is hope. There is light at the end of the tunnel. Oh, okay. But in seriousness, today we're going to focus on three points that James made. Not this James, the Apostle James. But yeah, the Apostle James, not me. I'm not an apostle. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Point number one, quick to listen. What happens if we're quick to speak instead of quick to listen? Well, Proverbs 18:13 tells us, to answer before listening is folly and shame.
The Message says it really clearly. It says, answering before listening is both stupid and rude. Even though it's very stupid, it's something that we often do, especially with our spouse.
Yes.
Sometimes we think that we know better than our spouse what they need or what they should hear. We generally assume that what we have to say is what they need and that they should be interested in listening to us. Now, sometimes that's the case and sometimes it's not, but we would be foolish to not listen to what they have to say. There are so many places where we practice speaking, but listening is rarely taught and it's generally neglected. In his book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, Stephen Covey says this, you've spent years learning how to read and write, years learning how to speak, but what about listening? What training or education have you had that really enables you to listen so you deeply understand another human being from that individual's own frame of reference? Listening is hard because we have to stop and put aside our own agendas and focus on that other person. We have to wait and force ourselves to try to focus on their viewpoint instead of expressing our own.
You know, speaking of looking at their viewpoint, that's the key of communication, understanding. And it's important to recognize it as the crux of communication. Now, I'm getting ready to get a little bit academic here, so stay with me. There are 3 stages of verbal communication. There's conversation, there's discussion, and then there's dialogue. Now, a conversation is like a one-way form of communication. This is when you just seek to have your opinions heard. For instance, say your son or daughter is getting bullied at school, or perhaps their coach is treating them unfairly or a little bit too harshly. You are going to go and have a conversation with that coach or that teacher. And you have no intention of hearing what they have to say, but you want to make sure they hear what you have to say. On the other hand, a discussion is like a back and forth form of communication, similar to, say, ping pong, where in the end, there is a winner. Think about a debate or a closing argument in a trial. The objective is to have your opinions or your preferences triumph over another's. And the problem here is that while at the end of discussions, decisions are actually made, the one with the biggest paddle is usually the winner. For instance, my wife and I like to have a discussion about what's the best sport in the world. I say that it's football. She says that it's tennis.
It is.
But I have all the America and the biggest paddle in that to say that it actually is football. And if we go a little bit step further and say it's the world, I have the whole paddle of the world for the beautiful sport of soccer or football.
It's still tennis.
And then there's dialogue. In dialogue, the objective is to have a shared understanding and a common view. See, dialogue works hand in hand with discussion, for it is in discussion where decisions are made, yet it's in dialogue where the complex issues are explored and a richer understanding of the issues is collectively attained. While new courses of action come from dialogue, new actions emerge as a byproduct of new courses of action come from discussion, new actions emerge as a byproduct of dialogue. Dialogue is not a substitute for action, but it should be. And it should be a precursor to that. By engaging in dialogue, we develop a deep trust that cannot help but to carry over into our discussions. Additionally, through dialogue, we develop the skills that make discussions productive rather than destructive. See, dialogue done right offers a safe environment for discovering the profound learning that it can lead to. But in order to achieve dialogue, there has to be a suspension of all assumptions by the individuals within the relationship and an acknowledgement that both parties are equals. Later in this message, we're going to give you a tool to help you engage in dialogue. Imagine, though, for a minute, if our state, our country, our nation, our communities, the world even, would engage in more dialogue and seek to understand. Perhaps the world might just be a better place.
So how can we understand another person? Thankfully, God gives us some wisdom in His Word. Proverbs 18, verse 2 says, "A fool takes no pleasure in understanding, but only in expressing his opinion." We all want to and are taught to express ourselves. In this day and age of so many different social media platforms, you can post on Facebook or Instagram, whatever you want, whenever you want, and not really think about what the other person's thinking. But in our relationships, we want to care about what the other person's thinking. We don't want to be selfish. In fact, that's the opposite of the attitude that Paul encouraged. In Philippians 2, verse 3 and 4 says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility consider others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but also to the interests of others."
You know, that's a really good point here about being humble while listening. You know, here's something I try to do every time that we enter in a discussion, especially if I know it's going to be a contentious topic. I pray. I submit myself to the Lord, and I say, "Lord, what are you trying to get me to learn in this moment? And how can I help my wife see you in me?" See, that helps me come humbly into the communication with the right attitude and also meet her needs as well.
So what are some tips for good listening? First, look at the person, not at your phone, or we like to call this a James TV.
We don't call it a James TV.
We do, because we watch shows on it.
Keep going.
Smile and look at the smile naturally, like a good natural smile, and look at the person. Ask questions to show that you're interested and to clarify any things you might not understand. Look for some common ground. Find those things that you can agree on. Put away distractions. Did I bring up the James TV? Seriously, electronics, phone calls, texts, Facebook messages, even your kids. Children are an amazing blessing, but you still have to make time for your relationship.
Here's some other tips. Actually listen. Don't focus on rehearsing what you're going to say, but truly listen to what the other person is actually saying. Don't assume or judge more motives. Like Laura said last week, you are not the Holy Spirit. That ain't your job. And if the person expresses strong feelings, try to acknowledge them without becoming offended or angry yourself.
So what can you do if you find yourself getting offended or getting angry, but you still want to listen? I'd encourage you to try a technique that James and I learned at a marriage retreat some years ago. It's called the speaker-listener technique.
Oh, this is good.
And this is a way of making sure that both parties get the opportunity to express themselves in a safe and constructive environment. I think it's best if we do a little demonstration. So I'll go over the rules. First off, you're each going to take a turn being the speaker or the listener. Now, to designate who the speaker is, you're going to pick an item other than the cell phone. Don't pick that because it's very, very distracting.
How about this pen?
You could use a pen. Any item will do. So whoever has the pen is the speaker, and they have the floor. That means it's their turn to express themselves. You are not going to say what you think the other person thinks, but use I statements. I might say, for instance, I feel taken for granted when you watch woodworking videos all night long. And then I'm going to pause and give James a chance to repeat back what I've said. Now, he's not going to say it word for word, but he's going to repeat it back so I know that he was listening. Just can you give an example?
So let me get this straight. You don't want me to watch woodworking videos to get better at woodworking for you.
No, he did not do that well at all, because what he's going to do is say in his own words what I've said. So he is showing to me that he understands what I'm saying. So some tips for that is to say, what I hear you saying is, or if I understand you right. You want to try it again?
Sure. So what I'm hearing you saying is that you feel taken for granted when I watch woodworking videos.
That was good listening. And now I'm going to pass the pen to James, and he will be the speaker for a brief moment.
I think I can do it.
Okay.
I watch woodworking videos to get better at woodworking for the things I make for you.
You like woodworking better than spending time with me?
Nope. That's not what I said. Let's try it again.
Okay, so I fell into that trap. But what I hear you saying is that you watch woodworking videos so that you can get better at woodworking.
Very good. That's good listening.
Okay, and so now it's my turn. We could stop there because we have come to a place of understanding, but I feel like we could come to a solution to this hypothetical problem. So I would prefer if you would spend some time with me before watching woodworking videos.
I understand that you would like me to spend time with you before I watch woodworking videos.
That was good listening.
I can do that. That'd be enjoyable. I'll spend more time with you before I watch woodworking videos.
That was good listening, and that was amazing. We've come to a solution, and all because we used a speaker-listener technique to help us come to this place of understanding.
You know, we did this little exercise, and it's a really good exercise, but more important than the words that your partner is saying is understanding what your partner is feeling within this exercise. Now, Kristen has no problems with me getting better at woodworking or even watching the videos. The problem was she felt neglected. Her feeling was that I was ignoring her or prioritizing these videos over her. So we came to a solution that allows me to do both, do the woodworking videos and treat her fairly and rightly, like she should be treated. So now we've covered listening, being quick to listen, and how we should listen. Let's talk about being slow to speak. So how did David ask God to help him with his communication? Well, in the Psalms, Psalm 141, verse 3, we hear, "Take control of what I say, O Lord, and keep my lips sealed." And again, in Psalms 19:14, he wrote, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer." Now, obviously, David didn't mean that he wanted God to sew his lips shut permanently. No, but what he is saying is, "Lord, let my words be your words and not from my flesh, not from my sinful nature. I want to say the words that are pleasing to you, God." And we all want to do that. Now, we can't get through life without communicating at all. In fact, Proverbs 10:19 clarifies that it's a multitude of words that generally causes the problem. Now, I have to admit, as an external processor and one who's known to have the gift of gab.
Amen.
That was an amen moment. But as one who's known to have the gift of gab, this is really hard for me. But nevertheless, we should avoid being overly talkative and loquacious.
What's loquacious?
Overly talkative. Also, we must be very careful to think before we speak and to choose our words carefully. Whatever we say should be edifying and intended to reflect the nature of Christ and to glorify God.
Since what we say is so important to God, let's look at what he says in his word about what we should say. Colossians 4:6 says, "Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how to answer each one." And Matthew Henry's commentary explains, "Grace is the salt which seasons our discourse, makes it savory, and keeps it from corrupting."
Because no one wants bland discourse.
Very true. We need some salt.
Some grace.
Yes. Now, Philippians is one of my very favorite books in the Bible, and I just love this verse, Philippians 4:8. "Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things." Now, if I'm honest, even though this is one of my very favorite verses, I struggle here a lot. I can be a glass half empty kind of person. I can notice the things that need some fixing and some improving and point those out instead of all the good things. But this is where I try to go to God and say, "God, would you please help me to notice these good things? Because I know that if I grumble about my wonderful husband, my 6 amazing kids, even my friends or my circumstances, then it's very hard for my wonderful husband and friends and kids to listen to me. And it's also not what I want the overflow of my heart to be." So I ask God daily or hourly or maybe more often than that to help me to think on these good things, because you talk about what you think about.
You know, that's a really good point. Can you say that part again?
Yes, you talk about the things that you think about.
That's good.
Now, Romans 12, verse 14 and 15 says, "Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep." Now, we want to speak kindly, even if our partner is not speaking kindly. God wants us to use kind words. He wants us to be wise with our words. So we want to have blessings and praiseworthy things dominate our conversation. You may have to be like me and pray over and over and
over and over.
Yes, over. God, give me grace.
So how should we say what we say? Well, Proverbs 15, verses 1 and 2 says, "A gentle answer turns away wrath, and a harsh word stirs up anger. The tongue of the wise makes knowledge acceptable, but the mouths of fools spouts folly." You know, the word used to describe a gentle answer is really like a wound being soothed with oil. A soothing answer is not ineffective, it's actually quite useful. On the other hand, a harsh word really means a word of pain. That is, a word that is hurtful. And we all do that. We send those words out that we know are going to cut deep in and hurt the other person. We have to avoid those. And when we wisely choose our words, and those words are wisely chosen, those promote calm interactions rather than provoking anger. So when we do it that way, and with the tongue of the wise, the things that we're saying, the truths that we may be saying, are going to be acceptable to the other person, rather than them taking us as a fool and just ignoring what we say. Proverbs 25, 11 and 12 read, "Like apples of gold in settings of silver is a word spoken in right circumstances. Like an earring of gold and an ornament of fine gold is a wise reprover to a listening ear." Sometimes, like Miss Laura said last week, sometimes you can be right and wrong if you handle it the wrong way. And the same applies to speaking. What you say can be right, but it can be wrong and taken that way if you don't say it in the right manner. Ephesians 4, verse 15 says this, Speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ. When we speak softly, kindly, wisely, truthfully, and with love, we can diffuse negative feelings and promote positive relationships. So we've covered being quick to listen. We've covered being slow to speak, and then when we are speaking, what we should say. Well, let's talk now about being slow to anger. And this one's tough sometimes, because let's face it, people often get on our nerves. They irritate us, exasperate us, slight us, provoke us, gossip about us, wrong us, offend us, take my favorite spoon, use my nice chisels as screwdrivers. They even buy the last roll of toilet paper in the entire state. Our patience wears thin, and we want to strike back in anger. But can I be honest for a moment? For those of you who know me, you know that I love hugging people and I love talking to people, but I'm not a people person by nature. You see, I had to train myself and learn to be a people person because God is a people person. And if God, who wants us to be long-suffering, to bear those injuries, perceived and real, patiently, and to forgive, if He's a people person, then I have to be. And see, God wants us to be people persons because we are His greatest creation.
And since God loves His people so much, Solomon has written several proverbs which praise the person who's learned this valuable lesson of not being angry quickly. Proverbs 14, verse 29 says, "Whoever is slow to anger has great understanding, but he who has a hasty temper exalts folly." Now, I looked at many, many translations of this verse, and they all say that if you get angry quickly, you're a fool.
Ouch.
Proverbs 15, verse 18 says, "A hot-tempered man stirs up strife, but the slow to anger calms a dispute."
Oh, in the first year of our marriage would have been so much calmer if we'd just been slow to anger.
There would have been a lot less strife without that hot-tempered man.
And woman.
Proverbs 25, 28 says, "A person without self-control is like a city with broken-down walls." Now, I love this verse, and I use it often with my kids because some of them are pretty quick to anger, at least sometimes. But I really like this verse for anyone. It's really so visual, and you can see that if you get angry quickly, things kind of fall apart. Like if my wonderful husband leaves his shoes all over the floor.
I don't leave my shoes.
And I get angry because we just cleaned up the floor and now there's shoes on it, then I can get, if I get angry quickly, I'm really just leaving myself vulnerable to get hurt, and all because of some shoes.
We have six kids. It's all their shoes, not mine. Now, because of all this, often married couples or really good friends just stop communicating. And one of the reasons husband and wives in particular quit communicating is they start to administrate their marriage. And they administrate it almost to death. Remember when we were dating and we were young and before we had kids, we would talk for hours and hours, whether we were together or whether we're talking on the phone. And this is before cell phones. We had to worry about the cord and all that stuff on the phone. We would just sit and talk, getting to know one another, knowing our desires, our likes, and our dreams. And somewhere along the way, though, we start adulting, and we let life get in the way of love and learning. Then we get caught in a destructive pattern where we spend our limited time together talking about work and the budget and kids and chores and so on and so forth. The communication becomes transactional instead of relational. Certainly, there's a need to discuss household management, but couples cannot allow business meetings to dominate their conversations. And the same is true with friends. When we get friends, we get into a period and a period and a place where we just view administrative stuff. And so we don't really talk. We just go through the motions, and we just go through the mundane things that we always do. And those administrative meetings often lead to arguments. And couples and friends become trained to think that talking will lead to conflict and disconnection. The problem is that when we unintentionally condition each other to feel that it's neither fun nor safe to engage in dialogue, so we just stop talking.
The key to good communication is found in knowing and being known. This means that you're interested in and curious about this person you're in relationship with. Listen when they talk. Ask open-ended questions. Your spouse or your friend desperately wants to be known.
You know, the other side of this coin is to let the other person know what's really going on in your life. Volunteer this information about your deepest thoughts, your belief, your feelings, your hopes, your desires, and yes, even your fears. They really want to know that, and it's good for the relationship. Good communication requires an active effort, but you can build a strong relationship if you offer to both know and to be known.
James and I didn't have marriage counseling before we got married. Again, that's something we highly recommend.
Amen.
I think we could have gotten along much better and communicated much better early in our marriage if we had. But thankfully, as new parents, we were in a small group right here at Manna Church, and a godly couple told us to do knee-to-knee time every day. And some people call it couch time. Some people call it couple time. It really doesn't matter what you call it. It doesn't matter when you have it or where you do it or even if your knees touch.
Or something else touches.
No, this is on communication.
I meant like, you know, I'll rub your back.
But set aside 10 to 20 minutes every day where you're just face-to-face talking. This is not the time to discuss problems or those topics like money that might get you upset, or woodworking, yes. So don't discuss conflict or problems, but just let it be an encouraging time where you catch up with each other. No phones or James TVs allowed.
You know, we joke about the phone and it's not a TV. But in all seriousness, it can be tempting to scroll on social media, the Instagrams, the Facebooks, the TikTok, and focus on someone else's life, or really their portrayed life, instead of focusing on the beautiful life sitting right in front of you.
Instead, consider asking some open-ended questions. Say, what was the best thing about today? Or how can I pray for you? What is something I can do to help you this week? These are all ways that you can encourage your spouse. And that's the whole goal, is to spend some time getting to know each other and encouraging each other, because you want to fill up their love tank. When your love tank is full, it's much harder to get angry.
And the same applies when you're talking about friends. You know, we all have love tanks, and sometimes it's our friends that need to fulfill them. But you're only going to do that if you really get to know them by asking those open-ended questions and actually showing real concern about how they are. So let us go back right now to our main verse for today. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Those keys are just really so good. we really should keep these foundational keys in mind whenever we communicate with one another. By doing so, we can train ourselves and our hearts to first seek to understand and communicate and engage in dialogue and live life together better. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these tools that you've given us. Lord, help us to humbly go into situations where we can learn to be slow to speak and slow to get angry, and first be quick to listen. Not just listen, but listen to understand and have a deeper understanding with one another, and so engage in dialogue so that we can understand one another. Lord, help us to, in our relationship, in our communications, to focus on displaying the light of Christ in everything we do. We ask these blessings in your Son, Jesus' name, amen. Now keep your head bowed for one more moment and one more prayer. You know, we are talking about this series about relationships, and one of the greatest relationships we could have is with God. That's the most important thing we can do. But the reality is that sin has broken that relationship way before we can do anything about it. You know, the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But the good news is that God still wanted a relationship with us. So he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross, die a sinner's death for us, even though he knew no sin. The Bible also tells us if we want that relationship, that we can confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe that in our heart, and we can have that relationship back. So if you know that your relationship with God is broken and you really want to do that, I'm going to ask you to do something right now. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. You can raise your hand digitally as well through the raise your hand button that you see there on your screen. And in a moment, I'm going to say a prayer, and I'd just love for you to say that prayer with me. You can say it out loud or you can just say it in your heart, but let's just bow our heads and say this prayer. Say, Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I know I'm a sinner, and I repent of my sin. I know that I need a Savior. Would you be my Lord and Savior? Come into my life. Come into my heart. Wash me, cleanse me, and make me right with God. From this moment forward, I'm going to follow you all the days of my life. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And amen. Now again, if you said that prayer for the first time, please click that salvation button. Please press that raise their hand button because we want to know about it.